Hello and welcome back to another movement and mobility routine. In this video, we're going to be covering my post-run routine. So let's say you just went out for a nice half-hour run or jog. Your muscles are probably feeling stiff and tight. So we're going to do a series of exercises, mainly flexibility focused. And so you'll need a foam roller and a soft tissue ball of some sort. So let's get started. For the first thing, you can put the foam roller and the ball to the side. Go onto your back. And what we're going to be focusing on here is loosening up the hips. So first, bring your left leg over your right. Bring your right leg out to the side a bit. And then use the weight of this left leg to draw it over towards your left side. So I'm opening up my right hip. We're working on the rotation in the right hip. And we're going to work on, let's say in general, separating what we're doing at our hip from our core. So I'm drawing in my abdominal muscles as the leg is going over to that side. We have 15 repetitions on each side, just back and forth. This movement is different for a lot of people because they think that when the left leg is on top, that then we're gonna be going over to the right side. But I actually want you to use the top leg as a lever or as a fulcrum to increase the weight of that movement pulling into the right hip. I don't want any low back sensitivity here. You may actually get like a low back cavitation or a pop as you do that because we're winding up some tissue tension in the low back, you could say. Keep going on and off here. We have five more on this side. Four, three, two, last one, and then switch sides. So now I'm bringing my right leg over my left, bringing my left foot out to the side a bit more, and then using the weight of the right leg to pull over towards you. And keep going on this side. Be cautious if you have any knee sensitivity. A few years ago, I partially tore my MCL and ACL on the left side here. And so as I go to this left side, I still can get a little semblance of some prior knee injury. And just be cautious with those sort of sensations. I'm not worried about really injuring anything because it's a slow and controlled movement, but just make sure that you're listening to what your body is saying. And especially if you just did this after a run where you find that your body might be a little tighter than normal, just listen to your body. Three more on this side. Two more. Last one, and then after this one, grab your soft tissue ball, and then you're gonna bring it to the upper outer glute area. And so to do that, go onto your back, the ball is way up into my right hip, and then shift your body weight over onto your right side. So here my left leg is still behind my right, and I'm just putting pressure into that spot on the ball. For some people, this might be very intense right away. Other people might have to search and find a spot that feels more tender. I know with myself, I'm right over that location. So I'm just gonna start with rolling my body back and forth real gently over the ball. You can do other variations here, but this is a really nice way to start off by putting pressure into the ball and then backing away. We have 20 more seconds here, and then we're gonna pause at a certain spot and then just do some deep breathing, sinking deeper into that space each time. Because there's some important nerves and other things that go down the back of your leg, be mindful that you are not causing any sort of nerve sensation. If you feel any tingling going down into your leg, into your toes, move the ball to a different spot. Find that tender point or that point of tension. And we're gonna do a few rounds of breathing here. So roll onto the ball where you feel more of that tension even. Take a deep breath in. And then on the exhale, let your body melt deeper, sinking more into the ground, into the pressure of the ball. Three more breaths just like that. Deep breath in. Sink more into the ball. Should feel more intense each time, but your body at the same time is relaxing, providing almost a counterbalancing effect. Two more here. Last one. Make sure you're breathing down into your belly. And let's do five more rolls back and forth because we put a lot of pressure into that outer hip, outer glute area. Two more. Last one. And then switch sides. I was just on my right side in the upper glute. Now I'm going to that same spot in the upper outer glute on the left side. So I start on my back using my right leg. Now I'm going to roll over towards my left side. And then there's a lot of pressure into that upper outer glute. Remember, no nervy sensations here. And then roll back and forth. What I'm doing with my right hand, which is my top arm right now, and then my left leg, I'm using those as the rotation pivot points. If I lift all that stuff up, it's a lot more direct pressure right across the ball. And I want to have some other contact points to make sure that no point of the movement is too threatening or too scary for my body where I almost tense up and guard, because I don't want that. If you're wondering if some stiffness or tightness after a run is normal, there's several variables that you need to consider. Now, if you're going for a longer run than you're used to, or if you're kind of at your max run distance, then definitely you'll feel tightness, soreness afterwards. But also know that just the repetitive nature of running, especially if you're running on a road, it is you're hitting the same contact points of the same muscles over and over again. So those spots are being used as if you were working them out over and over again. So some soreness is expected. Now, pain is a different thing, and I don't want you to have any pain when you're running. That's not normal. We have three more here. And then after this, we're going into those five deep breaths again. Last one. As you can see, I'm using my bottom arm here to support my head and neck. If you want to use a pillow, you can too. Finding that point of tension, take a deep breath in. And then all the way out, sinking deeper into the ball. We have four more. Deep breath in. And slow exhale. Deep breath in. And on the exhale, don't force it out. Just let it go. And what that does is it's a very efficient way to breathe where you're not using too much oxygen to exhale, actually. You're just letting the body do what it wants to do with the breathing process. Two more. Last one. Sink a bit deeper into it. And then five more rolls back and forth. After that, take the ball and set it aside. We are gonna do a stretch on the right quad here. So, and I wanna do that from a sideline position. So I'm gonna stay on my left side. From there, you can bring your bottom knee up a little bit, just bend it up to roughly 90 degrees, and then grab your leg, the top leg, so my right leg, where I get a stretch across the quad here. Now, if you need to pause the video and grab a band or a strap so that you can get your heel, that's okay. Or sometimes it's easier to bring it up towards your chest and then take up the tension as you go back. When you're in that stretch position, draw in your abdominals and then try to actively kick your top leg back a bit further. Holding the abdominals, we're gonna do 10 kicks back and forth. One, two, three. Each time you're doing that kicking action, you're increasing the stretch. The counterbalancing force here is the abdominal activation. So if you lose that, you'll notice that your back might bow a bit more or that you lose the stretch. Make sure that you're drawing in your abdominals and lengthening through your upper body. We have three more. Two more. Last one. And switch sides. Now I'm stretching my left quad so the right leg comes up. Again, my bottom hand is supporting my head and neck. I'm gonna bring my leg towards my chest to get that stretch. And then kick all the way back and relax. Kick back and relax. We have 10 on this side. Keep your core engaged. Don't lose that. Don't let it bow out. What that would look like if I am on my side is as I bring the leg up here, this area just drops and overarches versus staying drawn in and really getting the stretch across here. Three more. Two. Last one. And after that one, grab the foam roller. And then you're gonna go face down on the foam roller, working across the quads here. To do this, start with both elbows on the ground, and we're just generally gonna be rolling up and down both of the quads at the same time. I am using my forearms and elbows as the points of contact that are rolling my body back and forth then. Right now, my legs are in pretty much a neutral position where my feet are just going down towards the ground. If you want, you can roll side to side a little bit, shifting your weight left and right. You might feel your quad muscles are bouncing over the foam roller a bit. And then now, shift your weight onto your right side so that you're partially opening up your body and the foam roller is on all just almost exclusively on the front of the right hip and the right quad then. And then once again, roll all the way up and down. And then in 10 seconds, we're gonna add in some more movement to make this a little bit more challenging for yourself. When you found a point that feels pretty good, pretty intense, so like right here on me, then I want you to bend your right knee and straighten it out. Bend and straighten. You're gonna feel more tension as you're doing this bending and straightening action. And the thing I want you to be most mindful of here is as you bend your knee, don't let your back arch to compensate for that. So keep your core drawn in as you're going back and forth with that pressure over the knee. If you find that this is too much pressure on your arms, you can let your head and body drop down a bit, but you will lose some of the compression from the foam roller on your quad. We have five more here. Two. Last one. And then switch sides. So roll over onto the left side a bit more. Once again, roll up and down. Find a point that feels like it'd be a nice spot to work on. So for my left side, I'm going up a little bit higher, closer to the hip. And then you found that point. My weight is shifted onto that side and start bending and straightening. So for me, this spot is actually a little bit too much with my body weight. So I'm gonna roll off of it a bit and then continue with the knee bend and straighten. Most likely after some movement and blood flow and oxygen get to that point, then I'll be able to roll back onto that and it shouldn't feel as intense. So you go to the point of intensity, the point of a lot of sensation, and if it's too much, back away, but if not, work through that range. So now I'm gonna go back on top of it and it's starting to loosen up more. My body's recognizing that it's okay, that it's safe. We have five more here. Four, remember to keep your core pulled in so you're not moving your low back. Last two, last one. Good, and then you can put the foam roller aside, grab onto the soft tissue ball. And then here, this one is a little bit more work. We've done other variations for your calves before where you roll over the top of it. But today, with your knee bent up like this, my right knee's bent, the ball's in my left hand, I wanna work all the way along the back side of that calf, moving the ball up and down. Now, it is slightly more work for your hands and your arms, but I find that it's a little bit more specific also. And then this way, we can get the inside of the calf more. And I am taking this pretty much from close to the knee on the back of the calf, working my way down near the heel on the Achilles tendon. As we've done before, we are gonna stop at a point of tension here in just a second and then take some deep breaths with it. You're in control of the movement. The amount of pressure you give into your hand is gonna directly correlate with the amount of tension you feel. So I want you to be able, breathing into this movement is most important. So find a point of tension. I'm gonna be working right there, kind of right in the muscle belly of the calf, pushing in with probably 50% of my effort. And then we have 5 deep breaths here again. Deep breath in. On the exhale, push a little bit more and try to relax your calf muscle as much as you can. 4 more. Sit with that sensation. 3 more. Roll down about a half inch on that point. 2 more. Roll down a half inch more. Last deep breath in. And then just do about 5 to 10 more seconds of just generally rolling out that area. Okay, I just did my right side. Now I'm gonna work on the left calf here. And let's start off with your freestyle movement of doing whatever you'd like that feels good. I was doing some small circles on the other side. I like that a lot. You can also just generally roll from your fingertips to your palm. Here I'm going a little bit lower. That feels good hitting the other part of the calf muscle. We have one muscle that goes all the way up and across the knee, and then the other back calf muscle, known as the soleus, does not cross the knee, so it has a different function or a different action. Both are extremely important. Both have some similar functions and some different actions at the same time. So we need to be able to use both of them, but it's not really important that you know how to identify both of those on your own. Now on this side, I'm gonna be working lower. So earlier on my right side, I was up here. Now I'm down 4 or 5 inches. Do whatever feels right for you. We have 5 deep breaths here. Deep breath in. Exhale and push a bit more. Deep breath in. Big exhale. Let that calf muscle completely relax. 3 more. Two more. And last one. And 5 to 10 seconds, just roll it out. That should feel pretty good. Okay. After that movement, I want you to go and do what's called a half kneeling position. So as we do with all of our movements, you're gonna start on your right side. And then the goal here is to keep your heel down, but you're gonna lunge over the top, trying to get your knee going over your toe, and this stretches out the calf muscle here. So you should feel a stretch going across the back of the Achilles into the heel, and then back away. On and off with this movement, getting that stretch, and then backing away. Our calves for running are powerful. They're the most powerful muscle that gives us that push off for the next step. This is very important for our stride phase of running. So think about as you're doing this, if you were pushing off here, we're getting that length, that maximum tension that we need, and then we're relaxing. So this is giving us that ankle motion that's really important for running. Keep going here. We have 6 or 7 more. And the last thing I want to say before we get to the other side, if you look up and watch from the front view, you can see how my knee is staying out relative to my foot. Imagine that you're driving your knee over your 4th or 5th toe. The biggest thing that happens, the way that people cheat, is to let their hip come in, and then now you can see my outer hip. That's okay, I get some calf stretch, but for right now, for these final 2 on this side, think about pressing that knee out all the way. Switch over to the other side. Once again, we're bringing the knee over the fourth and fifth toe, keeping your heel down, and then backing away. If you really struggle finding the feeling that you need to here of getting that calf stretch, you can always do a different version where you're stretching the calf along the wall, or you are going into that downward dog position that we've done before. For some people, you might feel some compression in your knee as you get all the way into this position. That's a hard variable to take away while you're here. What I recommend is you can grab right above your knee and then go over, and that helps cushion it a little bit. But likely you need a slightly different movement through your knee for this one. We have five more on this side. Remember to keep that heel down. Keep your knee going out a little wider than you think. Three, two, last one. And then go onto your back. And then from here, we're gonna do a few of the glute bridges, and then we're gonna finish off with one more outer hip stretch. And this here is just to reset and kind of put everything back into a good position before you go on with your day. With this glute bridge, draw on your abdominals, tuck your hips under, and then do a small raise, engaging the glutes. From here, we're gonna add a small march on each side, and I mean a small march, maybe 2 or 3 inches. So we're keeping that glute activation. Now march your right leg off a few inches. Don't let your hips move in the front, and then back down, and then switch sides, and back down. Keep alternating right and left. I like to place my hands on my hip bones because I don't want to see any shifting or pivoting happening. Let's go three more on each side. Two more, make sure you're pulling in your abdominals and keeping that tuck under. Last one. And back down. The final movement for our post-run routine is gonna be to open up those outer hips a bit more. With this movement, bring your right leg over your left. So here, my right toes are kind of in line with my left knee. Pull yourself upright by grabbing onto that right knee. So here, my spine is upright and I'm already starting to get some stretch in the outer hip. From there, take your right hand, put it back down behind you. Your left hand comes over and grabs onto your knee. And then pull the knee towards your left shoulder and back away. Pull towards your left shoulder and back away. On and off, we have 10 more here. 9, 8, keep going. Use that back hand, the right hand here, to push your spine upright. And then take the left hand across to increase the stretch going across the backside of the hip. 5 more, 4, 3, 2. We're gonna hold the last one. Hold here, push up a little taller, draw on your abdominals, maximize that stretch, and finally switch sides. For this last one, I'm gonna stay facing you here so you can see this from a different direction. Now I'm bringing my left leg over the top of the right. Again, my left toes are in line with my right knee now. Both hands pull you upright. The left hand goes back behind you, pushing you up even more, and then grab onto your knee and start with that flossing movement going across the outer hip. On and off. You'll notice that it's easy to get lazy with this movement. And what I mean by that is, the back hand might want to relax, and then you can see how the spine will flex and round like that. That drastically changes the stretch in the outer hip. So what I want is up tall here, and then right away you'll feel more of a connection into the outer hip. if you are feeling symptoms more in the inside of the groin, or as if your hip is getting compressed on the inside, bring your foot out a little bit more and then see if you can change it there, if you can find that as a different stretch. Additionally, you might have to open up your leg a bit more. With that specific thing, the hip flexors in the front are trying to prevent or protect you from this movement. So work through, find an angle that works for you specifically. Three more here. Two more. Last one. And we are done for the day. So that is my post-run mobility routine. We did a lot of different things for the hips. We helped open up the calves, did some stuff that's good for healthy knees. So I hope you enjoyed the session, and I will see you next time.